Well, it's hard to believe it is the last Sunday of the year, but here it is. And we are looking forward to not only the finishing out the year well, we want to remind you that tomorrow evening, the last day of the year, we are going to have a traditional fellowship time here at the church starting at 6:30. I encourage you, it's just kind of a bring whatever food you want to come, bring it to share with people. And we have a suggestion from time to time if you're going to be with us. And we don't seem to go till midnight anymore in these recent years, but we do come and have a good time together on the last evening of the year. And you can bring some food to share. If you are one of our senior citizen ladies, and you want to team up with another lady to bring something, we don't want the burden to put on you nearly as much as those of us who are young and spry and you know what I mean. So bring some food to share. It always works out. Be sure and bring pecan pie. Just kidding. Don't start bringing a lot. No, just whatever you want to bring, it's fine. And that's tomorrow evening starting at 6:30. We eat first. We have bring some games to do. We're going to have the ping pong table set up. And if you don't know what round robin ping pong is, come and give it a try. It's a lot of fun. And some other things going on just to spend some time together. And we'll have some brief devotions and have some time together as we finish out this year as a family. So be sure and come tomorrow evening if you wish. The other announcements are in the bulletin. We do have those three thank yous that are there from the bottom of our hearts, those of you who have been gracious to do these gifts to pastor and staff at Christmas time, and we do publicly want to thank you for your gracious generosity. Well, as you think over the last year, where you've been, what has happened, which do you remember most, the struggles or the joys? Don't answer that. You just think about that in your heart, because we'll give you some quiet meditation time right now just to think. Think upon the blessings. The trials will always be there. In fact, both this morning and this evening, the messages are going to touch on that. It just so happens that it worked out that way, but this evening in the book of Mark, a very familiar story, but as Mark presents it about, what a Savior that we have. And so be thinking about and meditate as we have some quiet moments right now for you to talk to the Lord and just thank Him for the blessings of this past year.
Good morning. For today's scripture reading, we are going to be in Philippians, reading chapter 2, verses 5 through 11. So Philippians 2, 5 through 11. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant, and coming in the likeness of men. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross. Therefore God also has highly exalted him and given him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of those in heaven and of those on earth and of those under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for Jesus. We thank you that he was sent. We thank you that he was obedient, and we thank you that he died for us. Lord, we pray as we come together today that we would remember that. We pray for your blessing on these services. We pray for your blessing on Pastor and for your blessing on each and every one of us. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Please stand and we will sing together and bless the Lord.
Child of God. have sung to you this morning. What a great and awesome God you are. Today, as believers, help us to continue to think and to say thank you from the bottom of our hearts, what Jesus Christ has done for us personally. And again, today may be the day of salvation. This is my prayer and others, Lord, this morning. Thank you for work of the Holy Spirit. Thank you for this offering. And I pray, Lord, as we leave today, that we will go out a stronger individual for you. We know that the world needs Jesus Christ. We are your messengers and your vessels. Thank you for this time. In Jesus' name, amen.
Turn in your hymn books, please, to hymn number 56. To God be the glory. We'll stand together. We sing together hymn number 56.
Thank you.
This time of year is a unique segue where we aren't quite ready to release all of the Christmas music, but we're moving away from the Christmas music and doing some other things along the way, and speaking about still holding on to a little bit of the festive decorations. Those of you who provided poinsettias to help grace the auditorium, if you would like yours, please take it home today. We're done taking care of them. They're going to die here if somebody doesn't take care of them. And so if you, you who are left, and if you haven't gotten yours yet and would like to, just pick out the one that looks the best. Do not take those up there by the lights. Those are fake. I watered them. I think pastors confess more things before the people than anybody else. I watered the fake ones. So don't take those. All the rest, even the ones that are on the tiers, pick out the one that looks the best, the most healthy. Take it, and you love it, and you talk to it, sing to it, and maybe it'll be still around next Christmas. One more thing before we jump into our text for this morning. It's good to see Milton. Milton Howard, welcome home. When do you leave? That sounded funny, didn't it? When do you leave? Friday? So you have a few more days to hang out. Okay, great. We pray for you regularly. You know that. And it's good to see you. At the beginning of each year, we choose, actually I choose, a verse for the year. The verse for the year is something that is intended to be before us throughout the year. It's in the bulletin at the first month, first Sunday of every month. It's in print. It's in your bulletin. Turn with me to Psalm 18, because we're going to go back there, and typically what I have done for years is we start with a year verse in January, and this year it has been Psalm 18, verse 2. And at the end of the year, we come back to that verse one more time. Even if we've touched on it during the year, I like to come back to that verse and remind us of why we wanted it before us in the first place. Usually when we choose a verse for the year, it's meant to maybe be a challenge, a verse of challenge for us for the coming year. Or it's something more of a comfort to us to help us get through the year. And this is one of those, this Psalm 18, verse 2. And we're going to look at verses 1, 2, and 3 this morning. But just think of this title that we have for it this morning, Oh, What a Savior, because it really should cause us, when we think about all of this that is involved, in this particular verse that we have had before us repeatedly for 12 months, has it helped? Has going to it been a comfort to us, been an encouragement to us, or a challenge to us? Or was it just something that we saw at the beginning of the month in the bulletin? I hope it was more than that. I hope it was something that would be, in this particular verse, something that would cause us to well up with worship and thankfulness to God for who He is and all that is described in this. Because David is describing for us several things about God that would cause us to say, wow, oh, what a God, oh, what a Savior that we have. So let's read the three verses. And as we, on this last Sunday morning of 2018, we have already chosen the one for 2019, folks. But that's yet to come. Chapter 18, verse 1, I will love you, O Lord, David the psalmist. David writes, I will love you, O Lord, my strength. The Lord is my rock. We just heard a song, Rock of Ages, cleft for me. So secure, for all time he shall endure. And that's right along with what we're seeing here in this verse. The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer, my God, my strength, in whom I will trust, my shield, the horn of my salvation, my stronghold. I will call upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. So shall I be saved from my enemies. And as you go through this psalm in its entirety, which we will not be doing today, but in its entirety, it's a psalm, it's a song of David. On the day that the Lord had delivered him, and he was thankful to God for all that God is and all that David knew God to be. And as you go through this song, it's all of 50 verses long, but throughout it, David is saying things about he knows about God. He talks about God's mercy in verse 25, for instance. Verse 28, the Lord will enlighten my darkness. And various things that David has learned during his lifetime about God. So we look at this brief passage, just the first three verses, and we learn some things that were on the foremost, on the foreground of David's mind as he meditated all about his God. He mentions, I will love you, O Lord, in verse 1. Or in other words, you are my desire. I love you, Lord. If this is not just a fickle love, this is not the kind of love that is temporary. It's much more than a casual kind of love. My desire is toward you, Lord. I will love you, O Lord, my strength. He is the source of our life, or the source of David's life, is what he was saying. When he uses that word strength in this passage, that word strength in verse 2, Lord is my rock, my fortress, or at the end of verse 1, O Lord, my strength. It's the idea of, we have in the New Testament the phrase, Lord, in you we live and we move and we have our being. You are the source of my life. You are the strength. You are the source of my abilities. You are the source of my getting through life. You are the source. You are the source of my strength. You are the source of my existence. In Lamentations chapter 3, it is of the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed, because his compassions fail not. Acts 17, verse 28 is the verse that I just mentioned. It is of the Lord's mercies, or for in him we live and move and we have our being. So David begins this psalm in verse 1 by saying, Lord, you are my desire. You are, in a respectful way, you are the love of my life. Not in a human way, which we sometimes say that to our spouse, you are the love of my life. This is far deeper than any human love that David saw with himself, between himself and God. You are the love of my life. You are the source of my life. You are the strength of my life. Then we move on into verse 2, and several things are mentioned. As we continue, God is our high place or our rock, a high place, a cliff. And what this idea is not just a massive rock, but it's a high place. It is a place where God has taken David in a spiritual type of way, has raised him, like putting him on the top of a craggy hill where David could actually look down in a spiritual way and look at all that's going on in his life and be able, in a sense, to be above the difficulty, above the hardship. You are my high place. Even during the seasons of difficult times, you take me to that high place, and you are able to see my difficulties, or I am able to see my difficulties from your perspective, God. I'm able to see the things that I am going through from your perspective when I consider your ways, when I consider your desires in my life, Lord. You take me to that high place that helps me to be less confused about what's going on around me. The chaos that has been going around me when I have been pursued by my enemies, when I've been pursued by Saul, I've been pursued by people who wanted me dead. And God, you are my high place where you take me so that I can see from your perspective what you want for my life. You are my high place. You are my hiding place, a place of refuge. This word fortress is what that's talking about in verse 2. The Lord is my rock, my high place. You are my fortress, my hiding place. Whenever David was pursued, he wasn't always right. He always didn't do everything right, and we know that about David. But he understood something about the Lord himself being his refuge. You are the place to where I run. You are the one to whom I run. You yourself are my refuge or my hiding place. What is a refuge? There are not just a few words. There are many words in the Bible which refer to, especially in the Old Testament, which refer to that word, a refuge or a hiding place. Me'oz is a word which means safety, a refuge of safety. Manos was a noun which meant to flee or a place to run to. We would sometimes think about the cities of refuge that were set up for people to run to for refuge. The word Masa was a refuge or a shelter, Psalm 46. I won't read the references to this. But Misgav was a stronghold. A setter was a hiding place. But all of these words which talk about or refer to the idea of a refuge, they all mean the same thing. It's a place of safety. It's a place of security. It's a place of protection. God, you are my hiding place. To you I go. And that's David speaking. I wonder if it's ours as well. Do we run to the only one who can be our true and full refuge? God, as a metaphor, God is our refuge and strength. As David says, the Lord is my rock and my fortress, or my refuge. These Old Testament words that we mentioned, you don't see them in the New Testament. You don't see the word hiding place or refuge in the New Testament, and probably the reason for that is that when we have trusted Christ as Savior, we are already talked about or instructed that we are in Christ. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. So we don't have to run to our refuge, as David was talking about, running to God, who is my refuge. He is my rock, he is my high place, helping me not to be confused with what's going on in the chaos around me. And he is the one I run to for shelter, for safety, for security. But refuge in the Old Testament, you don't see it in the New Testament, with one exception in Hebrews, and maybe this is the only exception, Hebrews 6:18, which says, "We have fled to him for refuge to lay all hold on the hope that is set before us." My hiding place. Refuge. It's a safe place. "Because you have made the Lord your refuge, no evil shall befall you." Refuge is strong. 1,000 may fall at your side and 10,000 at your right hand, but it shall not come near you, Psalm 91. A refuge is security, Psalm 91. "You shall not be afraid of the terror by night, nor by the arrow that flies by the day." A refuge is solid. "I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge, my fortress." A refuge is a shelter, a covering. "He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty." Michael Ledner wrote that song, "You Are My Hiding Place." It goes like this. "You are my hiding place. You always fill my heart with songs of deliverance. Whenever I am afraid, I will trust in you. I will trust in you. Let the weak say, I am strong in the strength of the Lord." And of course, that was put to music. In Psalm 139, verse 5, it says this, "Thou hast been beset me behind and before, and laid thine hand upon me." David gives a similar thought. Basically, he's saying, "You're behind me, you're in front of me, you're beside me." In other words, I am surrounded by all that you are, God. "You are my refuge to whom I run. When I don't understand, when I'm afraid, to you I run." He is our mighty to save. My deliverer, that's the word deliverer in verse 2. He is my mighty one to save. The one who rescues. The one who makes free. The one who delivers. The omnipotent one who is mighty to save. For us today, we understand that he has delivered us from the power of sin. He has delivered us and will deliver. In 1 Corinthians 1, we have these words, "He, the Lord, delivered us from so great a death. He does deliver, and we will trust that he will yet deliver us." Again, being surrounded by all that God is. He is my mighty one to save. He is my Almighty, the I Am, the Almighty One. Or in verse 3, it is the phrase, my God, Almighty, the one who is in charge of everything. The one who is still seated on his throne. The one who is immutable. He will never change. He will always be almighty. And you are my Almighty One. A personal relationship that David has. You are my God. He is also our steadfast certainty. Again, look at verse 2. My God, my strength. Here the word strength is referring to an immovable rock, something that is huge, something that is secure, something that is never going to move, something that is never going to shake. That's you. You are my steadfast certainty. A lot of things in life that we are uncertain about. The uncertainty of, well, you can make a whole list of things. We face trials. We face times of testing. We wonder what's going to happen if there's not enough money at the end of the month. And the uncertainty of maybe a health situation. The uncertainty of the future. Although we don't have to worry about the future, that's in God's hands. But some people just are rattled by so much uncertainty in their life. David saw his God as his strength, this rock, this immovable foundation that is never going to shake. You are my steadfast certainty, O God. In the New Testament, we might refer to this as, Lord, you are my anchor. You are my anchor, the anchor of my soul. You are the one who will never change. In Hebrews 6, we read this in verses 19 and 20, which hope we have as an anchor of the soul, both sure and steadfast, which entereth into that within the veil, whether the forerunner is for us entered, even Jesus Christ made a high priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. And in Hebrews 13, 8, Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. Are you thankful that God doesn't change? I sure am. I'm so glad that Jesus is referred to as the same yesterday, today, and forever. And of course, he would be referred to in that way because he is the Son of God with the attributes of God himself, for Christ, God in the flesh. Our steadfast certainty. He's also our protector. My God, my strength, or my steadfast certainty, in whom I will trust, my shield, the shield, or my buckler, perhaps your version of the Bible says, you are my buckler. Well, what is that talking about? Well, it's referring to a shield. It's referring to something that is giving us protection. If you would go back to Roman days, and they had these massive, heavy shields that they would use in front of them for protection. They would sometimes cover the outside of that shield. In fact, the shields that they carried were so massive at times that they could hide their entire body behind that shield for protection. And sometimes it would be put on cloth on the front of the shield, and they would douse it with water. That would suddenly put out the fiery darts of the enemy shooting arrows, fire arrows at them. Protection. Protection. Lord, you are my shield. How many times has God protected us? Did you ever, you're like me, you've wondered. I wonder how many things that God has protected me from and I didn't even know it. Sometimes you get a glimpse of, wow, this could have happened. If I was 2 seconds faster on the highway, I would have been involved in this accident that just happened in front of me. Thank you, Lord, for protecting me by putting that shield around. But how many times has God protected us and we don't even know he did it? We will never know because it's happened and it's over with. But he is our protector. The Lord allows trials. The Lord allows storms. But you and I will never know all the times that God has stepped in and shielded us at times when we didn't even know he was doing it. I'm thankful for a God like that. Psalm 34:7, the angel of the Lord encampeth round about them that fear him, and he delivers them. He is my protector. He is also my victor. What does David say in verse 2? He is my shield and the horn of my salvation. Literally, this, according to Bible scholars, this is referring to a ram's horn.
What is a ram's horn good for? And I don't mean to put oil in it. I don't mean a ram's horn is, you know, you blow it, and like in Israel, they blew the ram's horn to call people to war or different things. No, I'm talking, what is the ram's horn to a ram? That's what really matters, right? What is a ram's horn to a ram? Well, that's what a ram rams with. Duh. But what's going on? If God is the horn of my salvation, what is this picture saying? Well, to a ram, the ram's horn is offensive, isn't it? It's offensive. Whether two rams are fighting over a girl or whatever, the ram's horn is an offensive tool. God, you are the horn of my salvation. The horn speaks of strength. It speaks of conquest. It speaks of conquest and victory, our salvation. Lord, you are the horn of my salvation. You are the conqueror so that I have salvation. And we put a New Testament application to that. The conquest that was won on Calvary. The battle that was fought and won, and Christ was victorious at Calvary as the horn, the victor of the conquest. You are my victor. You are my provision and my security. Look again at verse 2, at the end of the verse. My shield, the horn of my salvation, and my stronghold, or my high tower. King James, I believe, the old King James, I believe, is the phrase, my high tower. In the imagery of David's time where he lived, the walls around cities had towers, had high towers spaced around the walls of the city so that they could be a lookout, watching for the enemy. But those towers were also used for storage, for grain storage, for armor storage. And it could be that David, when he was talking about his high tower or he was talking about his stronghold, that it may have been a reference to some of these towers that defended the city. The towers where supplies and provisions were kept in the event of a siege. Those towers offered rest and security. God, you are my provision and my security. Well, what does David do at the end of all of this? You would do what we would think anybody should do after delving into all that God is in just these few verses. We should just kneel down and worship. Well, what David does in verse 3, I will call upon the Lord who is worthy to be praised. I will call upon the Lord. I believe that's identifying an attitude of worship. I will call upon the Lord. He is worthy to be praised. And so shall I be saved from my enemies. We would all have to admit that during 2018, God has been good to us. Over and over again, this year, God has been good to us. I hope some of you thought of at least a few things during our meditation time at the beginning of this service. I would also ask you, has this year verse been a comfort to you? Have you reminded yourself of not just this passage, but elsewhere in Scripture, where you are told who God is and what God does? I will pause for worship. I will also take refuge in Him. When the pressures of life are breathing down my neck, when I'm tempted just to try to run away or make it not happen instead, I should run to Him, my refuge. And I trust Him in the midst of the chaos. And one more thing as we wrap this up. As we think of what David was saying, Lord, You are my, I use the word our, the Lord is our strength, the Lord is our rock, and throughout the message we're saying our. David made it personal, as you read in yours. He is my strength. God is my shield. He is the horn of my salvation. The Lord is my rock. But we put the our, O-U-R. The Lord is the source of our life. The Lord is the source of our, or He is our place, high place. The Lord is our hiding place. The Lord is the mighty one to save. The Lord is the Almighty who never changes. The Lord is the steadfast and certainty for me. He is my protector, our protector. He is our victor. And as we put that word, the O-U-R, the Lord is our, it's all of us that know Christ as Savior. We are a part of this congregation. If that's all true for all of us, and it is, it was true for David, and by application we could say all of these things that David said about God towards him, we could say it's God towards us as well. Can we see, or can we make our church a refuge? Can we make our church to be a refuge? The year is almost over. It doesn't matter quite as much as where we've been, but where are we going? Can I see my church as a place of refuge? What do I mean by that? I mean this. As a refuge, is my church a safe place for us to be? I don't have anything in mind as far as the security team is concerned. That's a different subject. I mean, for all of us as individuals, do we make this place a refuge? Do we make sure that we see it as a refuge? It's a place where there is protection. We give protection to each other. It's a refuge. It's a place where we defend each other. The Lord is my defender. Okay, is this a place where we can say, here, my church is a refuge. It's a place where we defend each other. It's a place where we encourage each other in uncertain times. Is it a refuge? Where we can say to each other, I'm praying for you and it's going to be okay. It's going to be okay. I don't know how. And I don't know how God is going to work this out in the uncertain times. I don't know all the answers, but it's going to be okay. Because think of the God that we worship. Think of all that He is to us and for us. And in this place of refuge, we can shake a hand or put an arm on a shoulder and say, hey, we're with you through this. We're together in this. We have the same God. And look at all that he is. Can we see our church and make our church that kind of a refuge? Bow with me for prayer. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for this Lord's Day. In just a matter of another day, and we will be facing the beginning of a new year. May we take to heart all of your word, not just one passage, but all of your word. May we glory and worship you for what you have done in the past year to us individually, because all that you are. Thank you for your protection and for your defense. Thank you for your certainty, your strength. Thank you for your immutability. And you are a rock that will never shake. And we trust you. And may this place, this building where worship is supposed to happen and worship every day in our hearts between ourselves and you, may we make this place a refuge. In Jesus' name, amen. 151. A mighty fortress is our God. Let's stand together if you are able. You have done, all that you desire to do in the hearts and lives of your people. May we be your people and a refuge for each other. In Jesus' name, amen.